We are recording.
Okay, welcome to our Board of Control meeting. First on the agenda is roll call. Who's going to be calling roll?
Karen, if you could do that for us.
Sure, I'll be happy to do that. So we'll start with Jason Stein.
Present.
Jessica Cohen.
Present.
Thomas Zitch.
Present.
Susanna Nearman O'Neill.
Present.
And Mike Unger. Mike Unger, just so the committee, the people that just joined us will know, is stuck in a meeting and he's going to try to join us as soon as he can. So we have four members present, which means we do have a quorum. Three members make a quorum.
Okay, thank you. So now, it's my understanding that we're going to move directly to the Director of Planning, Mr. Zamp. It's your microphone.
Yes, good evening, everyone, members of Board of Control and members of the Metro Health team, city staff, and of course, members of the public. The purpose of tonight's, the subject of tonight's special meeting of the Board of Control is the proposed Metro Health Medical Center expansion. It's Board of Control case 2020-101. We have an agenda here tonight. Given that this is the first time the Board of Control has met in many, many years, staff's going to give a bit of a intro or a 101 to Board of Control, then talk specifically about the project. Then we'll turn it over to the applicant's team for a presentation by them about the project and why they want to do it. Then it'll come back to staff, Karen and myself, and we'll walk you through the approvals, the context of the project, our analysis of the project specific to the Board of Control, the process, our recommendation, and then we'll throw it to the mayor to preside over a board discussion. This is a public hearing, so there is a time for public comment. And then at the end of the meeting, we'll talk about if you would like to refer it to the Planning Commission. We'll talk about that later. As you all know, the Board of Control is the approval authority for Severance Town Center, which is right outside here of City Hall. That's the S1 zoning district. And that approval is really for everything that happens within the town center, the development plans, conditional use variances, etc. The Board of Control is made up of the following five individuals: the mayor, and we have Mayor Jason Stein here tonight; the chairperson of the Planning and Development Committee of Council, that's Councilman Mike Unger, who hopefully will be joining us later; the chairperson of the Planning Commission, which is Tom Zitch here; and then the chairperson of the ZBA, which is, I'm sorry, flipping it around. Chairperson of the Planning Commission is Jessica Cohen. Chairperson of the ZBA is Tom Zitch. And of course, the city manager, Susanna Nearman O'Neill. Now, we have four out of the five folks here tonight. And I know that Chairperson Zitch wanted to make a statement. So Karen, if you could unmute him.
Yeah, I believe I'm unmuted. Yeah, it's Tom Zitch, chairman of the BZA. What I do have to note, the applicant is a Metro Health entity, and I'm a partner in the law firm of Thompson Hine. Our firm represents the Metro Health Foundation, a related entity. And based upon how the Board of Zoning Appeals transacts its work and my professional obligations, I've decided it's necessary for me to recuse myself based upon that relationship from any decision that is made by the board, by this body. To the extent it becomes necessary to advance any action, Mr. Hohen, who is the vice chair of the Board of Zoning Appeals, could be delegated, but I believe we can proceed. I will, unless there is objection, I will attend the meeting, but I will not be taking part in the deliberations or any decision that's made.
Well, thank you, Tom. And I guess we would leave it up to the board.
I don't hear Eric.
Eric is frozen.
Let me see if I can help him.
While we wait for Eric to come back online, Susanna, do we have any anyone from the legal department on this in this meeting that we can ask for clarification?
Okay, everybody can hear me again? Okay, great.
I thought that Bill Hanna was joining us.
Is he on the call?
I don't know. Karen, is Bill Hanna on?
Yes, he is.
Yes, I'm on.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes, can you please speak to what Tom about recusing himself? What course of action would be best? Or what is your recommendation for the board? Should his replacement be at these meetings, or do you feel that's not necessary?
I don't think that it's necessary. The board is comprised of specified individuals, including the chair of the BZA, and so I don't think there's an automatic alternate unless you step up through the BZA structure. And if that's not necessary in that you have a quorum, I don't think that that you would need to take that step.
Okay.
And a quorum is three, correct? So you've got 4 - 1 = 3.
Okay. Eric, continue, please.
And just to make everyone feel a bit better, in looking at old Board of Control minutes, there were some occasions where they only had three, so it's not unprecedented. So the purpose of tonight's meeting is to consider the proposal by MetroHealth at their current location, 10 Severn Circle, to amend the detailed development plan to essentially construct a new 100-bed hospital building and include 12 beds in the existing hospital building, along with some reconfiguration of the parking. They're going to go through all of this, so I don't want to spend much time on it, but the true purpose of tonight's meeting, and you all should keep this in mind as we go through it, is to make to see if you're comfortable making the referral to the Planning Commission. They'll do a deep dive at their next meeting, which is on the 10th of March, and then provide a recommendation back to you. So there's a lot of hard work ahead, and tonight is really the beginning. But with that, just want to highlight some of the roles tonight, and maybe we should have even started with this. The host, your WebEx host, is Karen, so she's the one who's in control of the meeting itself. I'll help guide you through the process. Mayor Stein is the presiding officer of the meeting. Both Karen and I will act as the secretary, and of course you've got the applicant and you've met the other staff members here, including our legal director, Bill Hanna. So with that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and Karen, I think we're going to pass it on to Dr. Bruner and her team to talk about the project, and then it'll come back to us, to me, at the end of the meeting to walk you through staff's review.
Thank you. Karen, there it goes. It's allowing me to share a screen. So let me get.
Just take you a minute, sorry.
No, you're fine. I'm just trying to make sure I've got the right screen to share. It's set up a little bit differently. There we go. Can you guys see the slide deck?
We do.
Okay. Trying to get it to set up from a beginning, but it's going to a different screen. Okay, so going to give me just a second here. Can you all see this screen? Otherwise, I need to change it. Everybody's good?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay. All right. So thank you, City of Cleveland Heights Board of Control, for the opportunity to present this proposal to you. I'm Dr. Julia Bruner, Senior Vice President for Behavioral Health Operations at MetroHealth. And we are very excited to go over this project with you on the whys, and then the design team is going to go over the details on the what. I'm going to kick off with sharing some of these slides. So to begin, we're proposing an expansion of the Cleveland Heights Hospital to include 110 beds for behavioral health. And the reason for this expansion comes from a recognized gap in what's available in Northeast Ohio and specifically in Cuyahoga County. In 2019, the community needs assessment showed that there was a true need for enhancing mental health care and reducing substance abuse in our community. And we recognize that looking at national trends and per capita benchmarks, that the gap in Cuyahoga County is at least 200 beds in relation to acute care for mental health and addiction services. But clearly, we know that gap is likely larger because of the way hospital beds are assigned within Northeast Ohio. Most of them are adult only, many of them are private pay, and that only compounds the gap in relation to access to care. We also know that 1 in 4 Americans suffers from some form of mental illness. And we see this expansion as a way to provide the treatment that's necessary for those who are suffering with mental health acute illness, and providing that acute stay of 7 to 10 days to allow them the evaluation and the stabilization that they deserve. The other piece that we know is that demand is outpacing the capacity that we have across Northeast Ohio. Sadly, suicide rates have been increasing over the past decade. We know that approximately 260,000 people in Cuyahoga County suffer from mental health illness. We also know, sadly, that 32% of people seeking treatment don't get the services that they need from a mental health perspective, and 62% of people seeking treatment for addiction are also not getting the services that they require. Lastly, we recognize that over the last year, COVID has only increased the need for mental health care related to the strain of isolation, the strain of just general change in how people function in their daily lives. It's compounded this issue and this gap in relation to care. So our plan to address this critical need is to build a 3-story structure on the Cleveland Heights campus that will increase the bed availability to 110, and it will include care for adolescents, adults, and our elders. Its construction size will be around 75,000 square feet of new construction and 21,000 square feet of renovation in the current building. We expect to have an additional 155 FTEs working at this location in the fall of October 2022. And we know that our emergency department is going to shift and have the ability to assess this level of crisis at Cleveland Heights. We also know the value of managing chronic disease, chronic medical conditions that can be aggravated in a scenario where people are in acute mental health crisis. And so we're designating a unit specifically for that so that the care is holistic and not separated into silos. And we also intend to expand community behavioral health and addiction treatment with intensive outpatient services at Cleveland Heights. And that's part of that renovation piece that's listed in here. So with that, I've shared the whys, And now I'm going to transfer over the next stage of the presentation to the design team. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen and allow the next team to take over. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
Dan, you want to be able to share your screen, Dan?
Yes, please.
And Karen, I noticed that Mike Unger has joined us, so maybe I just put that in the record.
Thank you.
Sorry, I was late.
Okay, and I think Joe Hackney, were you going to, is Joe Hackney available? I think he was going to start it off for us. If not, I can.
Okay, can you guys hear me now?
Yes.
Great, all right, thank you. Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Joe Hackney with Anchor Health Properties. We are the developer for this project, and we really appreciate your opportunity to meet with your group and to present this project. Anchor is a healthcare company that manages and develops healthcare real estate all over the country. I'm based in Nashville, so if you guys have a hard time understanding my southern drawl, please wave your hands or something. I'll try again. Even though I'm based in Nashville, though, I've been lucky enough to work a good part of my career up in Ohio. I've worked with a lot of health systems down in Dayton and then in Cincinnati and then also up in Cleveland. So love working in your part of the country and looking forward to a lot more there. We've been very fortunate over the past year working with Dr. Bruner and her team to put together this project from the design and construction side to allow them to meet this the ability to treat this the behavioral health needs there in that community. I don't want to steal any of Dan Hurstein's thunder on the design side, but I'll give you a quick overview of the job. Dr. Bruner mentioned, this is a three-story, the new building is a three-story, 79,000 square foot building. It'll be attached to the existing facility by a two-story connector walkway. We also have a little over 21,000 square feet of renovation space inside the existing facility, and then the associated site work with some changes to the parking. I'll let Dan touch on this a little bit more when we get to the slides, but we also did want to note that we know that there is an adjacent buffer zone to the property to the east of us, and just want to mention for the group that we are, as designed, staying out of that area and not infringing on any of the other properties. This project is all being built on MetroHealth property. With that, I'll take a pause and see if anybody has any questions on the overall development, and then if not, I'll turn it over to Dan and let him kind of dive into a little more of the details, and we can go over the submitted drawings, or we can dive into some more updated renderings that'll show the layout of the building. So this is your meeting, however you guys want to proceed, but we're glad to answer any questions.
Okay. Well, if it sounds like there's no questions, Joe, so I'll go ahead and run through my slides. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay. So what we have on the screen is the existing site plan. As Joe mentioned, we are looking at a three-story addition to the existing facility. As we take a look at how we're going to do that, we're going to the east, and we're looking at developing this building on the current development within the existing parking area. You can start to see that we're trying to maintain that buffer zone along the east and south. And so I'll move into this. So this shows you that is the dedicated 150-foot buffer zone for the east and south properties. We are not touching any of that. As a matter of fact, we're saving a little bit more trees than that on the east side. We're not touching anything to the south. And we will be wrapping parking around the building to maintain the ambulance loop access to the ED area. And we've proposed to the city that we would land bag some of the parking based on a parking study that indicates that we would have more parking than necessary at this point with this current design at the facility. That would be less than the actual zoning requirement for parking. So we're proposing that utilizing that parking study report that we can even minimize the removal of trees and stuff near this buffer zone to even make it larger than the minimum 150 feet. So we'll rework the parking in between the MOB, and part of the site layout is we tried to mimic and mirror the existing facility, and we've done so we kind of consolidate the three entrances for the MOB, the walk-in traffic for the ED, and of course the new behavioral health building. This provides parking for visitors in between all three, and also provides a nice opportunity for all buildings and entrances to be very visible from casual observers to visitors. So it works out really well from that point of view, and we'll still be maintaining parking on the west side of the MOB as well. The two-story connection is the thin piece that comes into the corner of the ED, and that'll be connected at both floors, so patient and staff connections can occur there and create easy access back and forth for the support spaces for this facility. As we look at the floor plans, this is a behavioral health hospital, so we will have 5 patient units, with the first one being the adolescent that Dr. Brunner mentioned earlier on the ground floor, along with lobby and building support. And that's level 1 shown on this drawing. Level 2 and 3 are mirror images of each, not mirror images, but duplications of the same patient unit floor. So you'll have 2 patient units, a north and a south wing, on both levels 2 and 3, with that shared support for staff in the center in the green area. So it makes for a very efficient and staff supportive model. The intent is to match the existing campus. And so right now the campus has 2 colors of brick, a lighter and a dark field. Typically the dark brick is used in the vertical pieces like stair towers and elevator towers, and the lighter brick is used as field. It's got kind of a lightly blue tinted glazing with aluminum curtain wall and or storefront material. We are mimicking and matching all of those materials in the new facility. And here's some other shots of the banding. And you can see on the picture on the right, in the original MOB building, they use the dark brick. The accent brick is a base to the building. And again, up the stair tower there in that picture with a plane of curtain wall glass. In this particular picture, the upper portion with the light brick, the MOB, they use more of a ribbon glass design. And so in our design, we'll change that just a little bit. We're proposing a little bit more of a punched opening, and that's because of the nature of the patient rooms and the windows that we'll have inside of the patient rooms. But generally, we're matching the exact same brick. It's a Belden brick. We've found the exact model and numbers for those. So we'll be matching that for both the accent color and the field color. We'll be using the same glass type for the insulated glazing units, and be using similar aluminum anodized curtain wall and storefront members, along with some metal panels at places like the canopies and some trim work. These are a few shots of the proposed rendering and the connection to the right with the new entrance for the behavioral health facility directly ahead. This is a rendering of the east side, the backside where the emergency loop is, and another one of the entrance. And so that's the basic overview of our proposed building and materials. And Joe, I'll turn it back to you if they have any additional questions, or if they would like us to put up the actual Board of Control submittal package with a little more technical drawings.
Great, thank you, Dan. Any questions on the physical building at this point?
Well, Joe and Dan, I think it might be worthwhile just to go through with some of the detailed drawings. And then we were going to save the board discussion for later in the evening, because staff will have some comments too.
Sure, we can dive into some of the floor plans and it may generate some other questions as we dig in.
So this was our submittal package, and we included, and so Mike Woland, if you're available, I'll allow you to help assist through some of the civil drawings. So these do take just a minute to load in. I've noticed when we have all the videos running here on my screen, it takes a few seconds to load in each image. So this is just the overall site plan, again, kind of showing the building siting is in the dark gray boxes, the new building, and you see kind of the reworked parking areas.
You'll see we're able to maintain all the parking and the helipad over on the west side of the property, so all that will remain as is.
And as the next slide loads in, we are under any building height requirements, so we come in well under that. That was listed in that first page as well. Apologize, and my system starts to slow down here with the video, so. If it continues to be slow, I may end up having Adam go ahead and show this part of the presentation, but here is an example of the existing site plan and the demo plan. So we are showing some removal of trees on that east side and a little bit on the north side to make sure we get the loop road for the emergency ambulance vehicles to get around the new building. So we will be removing some of the trees on that north and east side. One thing that you notice on the south side, as you can see all these grade lines here, and so I'm circling it in yellow. Previous projects at this site had mounded excess dirt to provide additional screening capabilities to the residents to the south of this property. So that stays intact. We're doing no work down along that south side. So all of the mature trees and that earth mound for screening remains. We come up on the, as we're waiting for the next screen to load in, the one thing that I would talk about why we're doing this is we are looking at a phased construction process and a phased approval process through the building department and Rick Leconte. We are proposing and have submitted a parallel process for plan review of a site enabling package. So Karen, I may ask if you could switch this over to Adam's screen for sharing, because sure. Mine is just not wanting to work at the moment. But so as a part of that phased construction, we would be looking to build the loop road and establish a permanent loop road for ambulance traffic to make sure it had a free and clear path to the emergency department throughout the process. And then we would be coming back through and fencing off the area of the parking lot for the project, securing that area, and then starting the building process a little later in the spring, early summer. The gray area kind of highlights that new road area. I think we could move ahead. We will be utilizing in the next slide. So we will be utilizing existing underground detention basins. And Mike, if you'd like to add anything about the new detention basin that we have on the north side of the property?
Sure. Good evening, everyone. Michael Woolwin, Woolwin Engineering. This site will use two stormwater management systems, one at the southern end of the site. You can see kind of at the bottom right-hand corner of that sheet. That site or that facility is an existing facility, existing pipe detention system underground. We will be reusing that, and the rear southern portion of the parking lot will continue to go to that. We will be installing a new underground stormwater detention system along the north drive. That's what you see there, those little squares or boxes. It's an underground chamber system made by StormTech. You're starting to see them on more and more more urban sites. You may have seen them on other projects. They're bright orange usually, and they stack and lock together and provide a volume of storage beneath the paved areas. That new system on the north end will collect the new pavement areas as well as the water from the roof area. Will all be directed up into that new detention system, and then will be connected back into to an existing stormwater system in the parking lot in the front. That it will all be controlled and under the jurisdiction of both the city engineer, Cuyahoga Soil and Water, Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District, as well as the EPA. So everybody gets a shot at looking at that design.
And what
will be that will be constructed in phase one as well, I guess, when we're talking phasing. So that detention system gets installed in phase one.
Yeah, that will be under the loop road, and that will also delay any water or additional water that would be working its way into the city system in the street, right, Mike? And
that is right.
So. Okay, and I'd say the next slide.
That is an overall grading plan for the whole project. Again, encompassing both phase one and phase two. This just shows the overall concept on how the elevations of the parking area are being reused in the front. So the area that's not hatched in that front is an area of existing asphalt that we're going to maintain. That will be kept at existing grade. The new building addition is close to that existing parking lot elevation. And then it shows proposed contours around the sides and back of the building. So those are the intended grades once we're complete with construction.
Adam, I'll let you speak to the landscape plan.
Sure, this is our proposed landscaping plan here. We have a mixture of shade trees, street trees, and ornamental trees, most of which are native to the region. And we think we'll add an attractive look to the campus that mirrors mimics quite a bit of the things that are along the severance area currently with some new additions. Some of the trees chosen were for reasons they attract butterflies, they repel deer, some other things that I know Cleveland Heights is sensitive to. And we are trying to get as much shade and greenery put back into the site as possible with the amount that we were removing.
Yeah, Adam, I would ask that you do two things. Adam, could you circle the land bank parking area? So there's a few on there that show up, but want everyone to understand that these are the areas that we are currently proposing to land bank. And so those will not be built out at this time. And so along the east side that you just put a long rectangle in, the trees are not moved in that area as well. One of the things that I wanted to also mention is this landscape design by putting islands, tree islands into the visitor parking area. That's actually more than what was there before, as before was just a wide open sea of parking with no islands or trees. So this is definitely being put back in as an improvement with the shading in those parking areas. I think we could go on then. This was our lighting study performed by our electrical engineer, and he is not on the call tonight, so we'll allow you to ask questions about that later. But that should show that our light scroll and our lighting desk tapers off at the edges of what is our building area and prior to the buffer zone and treed area. Next, please. This is life safety plans follows. So this was for reference just to show the building safety components and how rated walls are used for defend in place strategies in healthcare or hospitals, where we put a 1 hour smoke compartment wall splitting the floors, which would allow staff in the case of an emergency to move patients from one side of a wall to another without having to exit them from the building, which is standard for all hospitals, not just behavioral health. Next, please. And again, this is colored floor plans that matched what we had shown earlier. So this shows the units. In this particular case, is just a security type plan to show different levels of security and safety issues for staff and patients. That was included in the packet. And then just a standard color plan showing the different areas. We do have a color legend down there to kind of indicate where patient rooms are, the patient treatment and program or social areas are, and staff and building support. So you can utilize that legend to understand more of the layout of the building, and we can answer questions to that. This is the proposed renovations inside of the building. This is the second level. So we would be looking at that 12-bed unit ICU adjacent to the already current 12-bed unit that was approved in 2017. In this particular plan, the CAD background does not show that there to the right. And Adam, you could circle that area, but that area has been built out and as again, that was approved in 2017, and that is an I-2 hospital use. Next, the areas in the peach on this particular drawing represent the areas being considered for renovation, the renovation portion of this project. Dr. Bruner and Joe Hackney had mentioned approximately 21,000. So we're working through the extents of the renovations in those areas right now. And then again, the rendering showing the material that's being selected is an exact match to the existing building. And we tried to use the different design styles to make sure that this is truly an extension of the campus that's already existing in Cleveland Heights, and it's complementary to that campus. And these were some similar images of the existing building. I will note that from our rendering to the existing buildings were taken last fall on some bright sunny days. So there's a little bit of sun wash on those. So some pictures you may not quite see the contrast between the light and the dark bricks compared to the rendering lighting that we would have shown with our renderings. But there is that difference between the field brick and the accent brick that's similar to our rendering. And I believe here's some elevations showing the same. So these are more construction documents that we did include, showing pure elevations of the buildings, which give you an indication of height and proportion for the window openings and the glass, the stair towers, which are taller in the dark brick, along with the field brick in the lighter colors. We included building sections for the Board of Control's consideration. So this gives you an idea, if we cut a section straight down the middle of the building, the spatial relationships and the heights of floor to floor ceilings and floor to floor dimensions. And the next one allows you to take marker sections off of this building section into the wall section.
This is the end of our, there's only 16 slides here, Dan, so I think on the architectural submittal.
And so that's it.
Yeah, Dan, Joe, Adam, Michael, Dr. Bruner, thank you. If Karen, if I could get the presentation back from Adam, we can continue. Okay. So we thought that having that very detailed presentation by the applicant was important because the Board of Control, while you have some very specific roles in terms of the S1 district, in terms of approving the conditional use, the variance for the reduction of parking, and ultimately the amendment to the detailed development plan, the question here tonight is this a project ready and worthy to go to the Planning Commission? And that's because we sort of debated internally and with the law department about if this actually did need to go to the planning commission. But given that it's a new building and a somewhat big change to the site, that would fall under the category of substantial change. But hopefully you saw tonight through this presentation that they've presented a lot of information. They've addressed a lot of probably the concerns and questions you may have. But before we get to your discussion, I wanted to walk you through staff's review of this and give a little context, which you all know. But of course, here's Severance Town Center. You see the project site immediately adjacent to the existing building. And as Dan and his and the team mentioned, there are that 150-foot buffer to the east and to the south. That's very, very important. There's a long history here on this site dating back to 1996, and most recently with some variances in 2018. We know the existing conditions. This is just the sheet that you saw a couple times tonight. And here's the plan, and there's a lot of thought that went into this plan, a lot of back and forth with staff about how to make sure that that the existing neighborhoods are protected, how the space can be greened up. And we think that this plan does that with the land banking of parking and the additional plantings. And of course, the design looks very much like the existing building. But do note that there's that entrance sign, which will have to go through a separate process with the Board of Control. Again, that's not uncommon. That's happened in the past, even on this site, where the signage went through its own process. So your role tonight and your role ultimately later in the month, should everything proceed, is to answer a couple of questions. First one is the use permitted? The Severance Town Center has a subsections or sub districts, and this is in the perimeter subdistrict, so not the inner core, but the perimeter area. That perimeter subdistrict allows uses permitted in the C1 and MF2 districts. Hospital is permitted as a conditional use within those districts and therefore on this site. The perimeter subdistrict has that 150-foot buffer as a key element of it, and that's being maintained with this project. A second question that you need to ask and hopefully answer is, does it meet the objectives of the planned development regulations within in the code? And we did detail a lot of this in our staff report, but tonight I just want to run through very quickly that in fact it does meet all of those objectives. The first one, does it provide an opportunity for new and innovative development in the city where there's vacant land or special redevelopment opportunities? And yes, this is a sort of underutilized portion of the hospital site. So reusing that for a hospital use would meet that objective. Does it protect the residential and commercial property values? Yes, the expansion would actually hopefully increase property values for both residential and commercial uses within the city and especially the neighbors. Does it safeguard the aesthetics of the city's residential and commercial neighborhoods? It does, especially where it matches the existing building. And note that the ABR review is required for this, and they will be meeting for a preliminary review a little bit later tonight on this, although luckily for all of us, that's a little bit later on the agenda, so we do have a little time. Would it encourage sustainable development practices? Yes, it does reflect the sustainable approach to development in that it's being proposed to be developed on an already existing parking lot. And there's a number of sustainable practices that are being proposed as part of the project. Does it promote both residential and commercial development? Let me just move this. And where appropriate, mixed use development? Yes. This is the type of project that will create jobs. As you heard from Dr. Bruner, it will create 155 full-time jobs in the beginning and hopefully 255 by 5 years in. Is there a process that's in place to make sure that there's flexible development regulations? Well, the entire S1 district and the Board of Control has its own process. And so, yes, it does meet that objective. And does it protect residential neighborhoods from commercial encroachment? Yes, the project maintains that 150-foot buffer as detailed. So the Severn neighborhood should not be impacted by the project. A third set of questions that the Board of Control needs to ask and answer are, does it meet the general standards for the conditional uses? And again, there's 12 of these. The answer is yes, it meets all of them. Run through it very quickly. Is the use itself in the general accord with the objectives of the code and the district? Yes, it's within the definitely within the objectives of the S1 district. Will the use endanger, will it not be detrimental or endanger public health, safety, morals, comfort, or general welfare? The use itself will not do that. Will the use be designed, constructed, operated, and maintained to be harmonious with the general vicinity? Yes, that's a big part of the project, is to be similar to the existing building and to maintain that 150-foot buffer. Will it not be injurious to the use and enjoyment of other property in the vicinity? No, this just continues the hospital use that's already there. Will the establishment of the use impede the normal and orderly development of surrounding property? This is just an expansion of an existing use, so it should not impede that development. Are there adequate utilities, access roads, drainage facilities? And you could include in their parking, yes, there would be, and there'll be full-blown processes during the building permit review for all of that. Have adequate measures been taken to provide ingress and egress? Yes, it's and part of the first phase of this is to make sure that ambulances can still access the facility while construction is going on. Will the establishment of the use should not be detrimental to economic welfare of the community by creating excess burden on community services? This should not. In fact, it should help decrease that burden. Is there minimal potential for future hardship on the use itself by being surrounded by as of right uses, and no, as experienced by the hospital use being there for all these years, there should not be a future hardship. And two more, does the conditional use address the sustainability guidance that's in our code? It does. There's some big, great detail in our staff report. We can talk more about that should it come back to you later this month. And finally, does the conditional use conform to the rest of the district and the supplemental conditions of the code? Yes, the only exception, of course, being the parking requirements, and the applicant has asked for some relief on that. And that leads us to a fourth question, which is, well, what about parking? We know parking is a big issue within the community. The code requires 700 spaces. The applicant got a third party parking needs assessment from Walker Consultants. They looked at the demand, both existing and in the future, and determined that it was lower than required by the code. So the applicant has requested a reduction in the spaces to 402 spaces. The project itself includes those 86 land bank spaces, which is beneficial to increase open and landscaped areas. We're supportive of the request, but the board should note that the zoning administrator, which would be myself, has the ability down the road to request that the land bank spaces be converted to spaces, actual spaces, and that would be a condition of any approval. And what's also interesting to note, and we encourage you to read the Walker Consultants report, is that they recommend a whole bunch of other recommendations to both the existing and future parked areas. And I think we're supportive of those being integrated into the project. Those are things like striping and repaving. So there's a big process that's involved. That's really what the Board of Control is about, is a process. But I want to highlight here that there is a lot of opportunity here for interaction and questions. We're meeting right now in that first bullet as the Board of Control. The ABR will be meeting later tonight to get that preliminary review of the architectural and aesthetics. The applicant has set up a community meeting for the Severn neighborhood for this Thursday, the 4th, at 7 p.m. And that's led by them. Karen from the city will attend just to be a city representative. Should the Board of Control refer this to the Planning Commission, they would hold their public hearing, review, and potential recommendation on the 10th. The Board of Control then could meet again on the 11th for approvals, potential approvals. The S1 district requires that the City Council considers that approval of the Board of Control, whether it's an affirmation or an actual adoption of the adoption. And then should the ABR not come to any approvals tonight, then there would be another ABR meeting at the end of the month on the 16th. So it's a tight schedule. And that's why our recommendation is for the Board of Control to really get this process moving by moving it on to the Planning Commission. And then we can have their deep dive and then more review by staff in time for the Board of Control later this month. Just to note that there are plenty of opportunities for public comment and questions. All the materials are going to be posted on the website. I think we'll use the Board of Control page, so we have that link there. That will include this presentation tonight, and hopefully we can get MetroHealth's presentation and include it there as well. If you have any questions, please contact myself or call the office with the numbers above. We are asking, like the City Council does, to have comments sent in via email. You can see the information here, or they can be mailed to my attention here in City Hall. And with that, the last part of the meeting, or the next part of the meeting, is a board discussion, which would be presided by the mayor. And that could be questions of the applicant, of staff. This is a public hearing, so there is an opportunity for the public to comment. What we would do is we would have Karen unmute the attendees and see if anybody wanted to comment, reminding everyone that this is the first opportunity. And then should the Board of Control wish to proceed, then there would be a referral to the Planning Commission that would be presided by the mayor, would be via a motion and recorded by the secretary, which would be Karen / myself. And then, of course, adjournment at the end of the evening. So with that, I'll stop sharing the screen and turn it over to you, Mr. Mayor, to preside over the discussion portion of the meeting.
Thank you, Eric. Are there any questions, any comments from the board members? Raise your hand, be recognized. Mike?
Well, first, I just want to say thank you to our staff. I think that was a wonderful presentation. Obviously, a ton of work went into it. Ditto to MetroHealth and your team. You guys have been wonderful to work with. Thus far, seems to me you've done just about everything we've asked of you, and then some, and done it right on cue. I see no reason. I do have a question, but I first want to say I see no reason to delay anything. I completely favor staff's recommendation to refer this thing to Planning Commission with a high degree of dispatch, so that this can move forward. What I'm interested in, with apologies to the MetroHealth folks, because your existing facility just happens to be, in Severance, which is just a hotbed for discussion. I also want to commend you, MetroHealth, for holding that community meeting and getting and allowing all sorts of venues for community input, which you pledged to do at the beginning. And once again, it seems to me you totally lived up to that commitment. But what I'm interested in is in staff's sort of, best, predictive analytics in terms of, recognizing that I'm asking you, Karen, and you, Eric, to look into that crystal ball and try to predict what kind of an impact this is going to have on Severance, which has, afforded so much, has commanded so much of our attention and so much discussion within the city, sure to be a political hot potato in the upcoming races for mayor and city council. but you know, just from staff's perspective, how do you see something like this playing into the master plan and all the discussions that we've had as a community about what to do with respect to severance as a whole?
Well, I'll take a shot, and I would be curious to hear Karen's thoughts as well, since she's been around much longer than I have. But I think this helps the conversation when you have a significant property owner and a stakeholder doing a significant investment in a Severance Town Center. It shows that that there's life to the place, and that there should be continued interest for others to want to sort of latch on to what's going to be a hotbed of activity with all the employees and people who are unfortunately having to go there. But you know, they're going to go to the Daves and to the Home Depots and whatever else we can hopefully see here. So I think it just shows that Severance Town Center is an important place, and that that master plan needs to really be revisited and acted upon.
I can just jump in if it's all right with you, Mr. Chair. I just want to echo what Eric just said. I agree. I think that this is a significant investment by what will become an anchor employer right here in the circle. So I think that addition of employees will do, just as Eric said, add some vitality to the circle and the activity that goes on and the businesses that do remain here.
Jessica.
Thank you. So I absolutely share Mike's gratitude to the staff. So thank you so much. I think this is a very well-prepared presentation. Mm-hmm. I agree. I have seen no reason why we shouldn't send it to the Planning Commission. As the chair of the Planning Commission and knowing some of the conversations that we had, I want to make a request, if it's possible, to have this done by the Planning Commission meeting and made as part of the presentation. Often we see that residents would like to see what they will see from their backyards, and we saw this with the Oakwood development, and you have the elevations and you have the landscaping, you have the 150 buffer, but I believe that when we had the Oakwood development, planning staff actually went out and took some pictures as to, and I'm sorry to make you trudge through the backyards of Severn, but took some pictures to see, and then if you know the Metro Health design team could overlay, you know, the elevation of the new building, it would be really helpful for us to see that. And then if there is any residential, I'm not sure how that would work on the other side, you know, by Wood and Crest on the other side of Milliken. There may not be an overlap with residential there, but if there is on that northeast side, that would also be helpful for us to kind of see what this new view is for residents. So that's my only request, and I'll give it back to you, Jason.
Anyone else want to speak? Or did Metro want to respond to Jessica's request?
So I think the question is to have some pictures taken from the back area so that you can understand the elevation components. Mm-hmm. Joe, what are your thoughts around that? Joe Hackney. We can't hear you, Joe. There we go.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. I think it would be a lot easier if this were in the summertime, because there would be no impact and nobody could see. So on the plus side, the major construction will be taking place during the summer. So when those trees are full, they're, it really will block a lot of what they're seeing. So no major changes there. And like Dana mentioned before, there's a pretty significant berm of dirt that's going to really block a lot of the sound. So I think on the residential side of the south, they're going to be pretty well protected. But I am really happy to volunteer Adam, since he lives there in Cleveland Heights, to volunteer some more of his time. He's been so gracious about going out and doing a lot of legwork. So it's really easy for me to say, yes, we'll do that. But no, in fairness, Adam, if you're able to, go to the south side and see what we think that view would look like, that'd be a great help. If not, we'll figure out how to get somebody else there to get some photos and see if we can't get the elevations in a perspective where we could see what that impact would be.
Yep, I can definitely do that, and we can put them side by side to show the view. We saw a couple of those views from the east side of the property with the renderings that show kind of the view from the ambulance drive, and we kind of superimposed that side by side and just add some trees in the foreground to show what it will look like through those areas. But the buffer to the east is currently 150 feet plus the parking lot, and then to the south is another 100 feet plus the 12 foot tall berm. So I don't anticipate much of a view, but I can go out and get some from wooded areas just to drive that point home for sure.
Yeah, I mean, I'll just add, you know, we can kind of get a sense for it, you know, from the description and from the designs, but I know that the community really appreciates, you know, having a visual that they can say, okay, now I know what it's going to look like, you know, at the end of this.
I didn't want to volunteer, Adam. That's why I asked Joe to do it.
That's okay. I was going to volunteer Adam next if Joe didn't do it.
So. Not a problem. I'll just try and wear something that makes myself look very unassuming so I'm not in someone's backyard and frighten anybody. Not a problem.
Right, thank you. Susanna.
I also want to say that this is such a strong plan and such a good presentation from our staff. I am particularly appreciative of the attention to the landscaping around the site. I know you really put the time in with that because you know that is just so important to our whole community, but in particular the neighborhood. So I'm very appreciative of that. Also, just to echo what Eric commented, staff commented, this does bring additional vitality to the Ring Road of Severance. And the look of the building, the way you've matched the brick and the design, this plan, I totally support. It should go to the Planning Commission. So thank you.
Okay, what is the next step? I believe it's public, from the public now, Eric. So does it go back to you?
Yeah, if Karen could unmute everybody, I think we have six attendees. So if anybody wanted to speak.
We do, and they put in a couple questions in the chat. I'm trying to unmute, there we go. So those of you that are present, I am unmuting you when I can. For some reason, some of you I'm not able to unmute. So I can see that I did have a question from Michael Morse about the trees. He was not clear exactly where the trees on the east were gonna be removed. And another resident in the chat is just asking again about the behind the woods of where would the building be. So can you just explain again which trees are remaining and which trees will remove? So you know, there was a note that the east side does not have a berm, so they're curious as to the number of trees and where those trees being removed are. I can throw the share back to somebody to show a site.
Probably, Adam. I would share the PowerPoint presentation with our sites before and after. Those first three slides, I think, really help emphasize that, and we could potentially add some mark to that if you have that available.
Sure.
And while you're doing that, I don't know if this Q&A went just to me or if you can see it too, Karen, but there's a question about we should also have views from the east side as well. So I think echoing what Jessica said is there should be, if Adam can go out there and do a couple of views from the east side, that would be good too.
Not a problem. If you can let me share again, I'll pull this up on screen.
You, Adam, sorry, I go to Dan. There you go.
Okay. All right, so here's the existing, and you see right here, let me scroll ahead a couple of slides here. Here's the existing with the current proposal overlaid over top of it. You can see faint dark lines here are the property lines, the property boundary for Metro. This black line here is that buffer zone that currently exists, which is right here. So we would be taking out just a portion here for one tray of parking plus the ring road. The part you see to the right of that is the land bank portion, which would not be taken out during this first phase. That would be only if the city deems that parking necessary in the future. So what you're looking at here is a, Mike, correct me if I'm wrong, it's about a 28 foot wide ambulance drive with another 20 feet for parking stalls. So roughly 48 feet or so beyond the existing tree line. It's just this portion here, and then up to the north, there's a smaller portion of trees being removed just for the ambulance ring road.
And so I think another way to describe that is the 150 foot buffer zone shown in green, that will all remain, plus an additional approximate 20 feet beyond that, which is the length bank. So, you know, to add a point, probably removing somewhere between 40 and 50 feet, but maintaining about 120 feet of that area on the east. And on the south, we're not touching that area at all.
That is correct.
Correct. And we did a quick takeoff of that square, you know, rough square footage area of trees being removed. And we tried to put back with our plantings and our shade trees, roughly that amount of coverage. We couldn't quite get the exact amount just based on the site constraints, but we did put back as much square footage of shade and trees throughout the campus to try and make up for that. And like Dan said earlier, they're the interior parking islands that currently don't have any trees were added. We added islands and trees in there as well to reduce the island effect and some of the and just add some shade to those interior areas. But there's a row of trees here that are we have a red maple that's going to have a nice flowering red color, and then a big tall green maple next to it that'll kind of also buffer that view from the residents in addition to the buffer that exists.
And as well, that whole area between the eastern drive, the ambulance drive, and the building itself will be landscaped as well. So that little parking lot in the middle is land banked. So until or if that ever gets built, that whole area is landscaped as well.
Mr. Chair, I have all of the attendees unmuted. If you want to see if anybody has any additional questions.
Okay, so this is the public. We're opening it up. If you would like to ask a question or make a statement, please announce your name, your address, and then let us know, you know, what your concerns are. Is there anyone that would like to speak? I'm not hearing anyone.
No.
Okay. Then I guess they, if you do have a question or any comments, of course, there is the email that our director of planning has offered, as well as, of course, always the normal route. So through city council, you can let us know your concerns. Okay. So I guess go ahead, Karen, and you're muting them now. So.
Right, I'm re-muting everybody.
Okay. Okay, then, and Eric, if I remember correctly, then the next step is to entertain a motion to refer this to the Planning Commission for full review?
Correct.
Okay, do I have such a motion from one of the board members?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, now we already had the discussion, but I'll give it one more option. Does anyone have any other items they want to discuss relating to this before we vote? Okay, Karen, please call the roll.
So let's go ahead and start with Jessica Cohn.
Yes.
Jason Stein.
Aye.
Mike Unger.
Aye.
Susanna Nearman O'Neill.
Aye.
And did I miss anyone? I'm sorry.
No, but if the record could show, as I noted before, I have recused myself from the consideration of this matter and therefore will not be voted.
Sure. So Mr. Chair, that's four ayes and one member who had to recuse himself.
Okay. So that passes. That'll move on. We have a tight schedule. It appears we'll be back in within the next couple of weeks, hopefully, to discuss this again. I don't see anything further on our agenda. Therefore, this meeting is adjourned. and have a good night, everyone. Thank you so much, Dr. Bruner.
Thank you, everybody. It was great
seeing
you all again. Hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.
Appreciate it. Bye-bye.